Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the presentation of the colors. The colors tonight are being carried by women of all the five services, accompanied by the original women's service songs. The WAC is a soldier too. The Women Marines.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, where so gallantly streaming. Bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Brigadier General Wilma Vaught.
Gee, I wish we'd thrown a party and somebody had come. I don't know how many people we have tonight, and I probably don't even want to speculate in case the fire marshal's here. But I suspect it's in the vicinity of 9,000 people. And I think we just broke a record for the most military women and women veterans ever to be in one place at one time. We set the first record. We set the first record at groundbreaking. We've just exceeded it, and we're going to break it again tomorrow at dedication. I know no one had to wait for a bus today. Let's see now. It's time for one really great moment in history, because I want to introduce at this time Mary Elcano, who is a senior vice president and general counsel with the United States Postal Service. Mary, come out here.
Thank you, General Vaught. It's a pleasure for me to be here tonight at the reunion. It's about time. It's about time we recognized the courageous actions of the women in the military service, the women who stepped forward in valor. Many times you were not called, but when you were needed. We're here tonight to thank to the thanks of Brigadier General Wilma Vaught. Let's give her a hand, ladies and gentlemen. And we're also here tonight thanks to the encouragement of the Women in Military Service for America Foundation. You gave us the leadership and support for this special commemorative stamp the Postal Service will dedicate tomorrow, and we thank you for that. I come from a military family. I'm an Army brat. My father was a career military officer, and my mother, Marion Rebecca Elcano, was a nurse in D-Day and in the Battle of the Bulge. So you can understand how personally thrilled I am to be here on behalf of the Postal Service and to be a part of these extraordinary events. It's about time. It's about time we recognize these courageous women, and I'd like to name a few who have Postal Service families. Jane Bullard, a Navy nurse in World War II. Doris Flaherty Driscoll, a Marine sergeant in World War II. Kathleen Brennan Kapler, an Army nurse in the China-Burma-India Theater, a woman who took the scenic route from Philadelphia to the Himalaya Mountains to provide medical support for air crews who flew the hump. Rita Oswald Walford, who designed airplane parts for B-17s and B-52s during World War II. Anora Kellady Ketting. In the Women's Army Corps, she served as secretary to General Hody. And finally, Christina Alvarado Shanahan, a nurse in Desert Shield and Desert Storm. Tomorrow, at the Women in Military Service Memorial, we will salute all of you, the women, past, present, and future, who believe in and defend the United States of America, the women of the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard. It's about time. And it's about more than that. It's about duty fulfilled, and honor upheld, and freedom defended, and recognition that is richly served. In honor of tonight's special event, I'm pleased to give you a sneak preview of the commemorative stamp that we will issue tomorrow. At this time, I'd like General Vaught to rejoin me, Congresswoman Jane Harmon, and Marion Elcano, my mother, to join in unveiling the Women in Military Service commemorative stamp.
The background of how this stamp came to be. We had a field representative named Mary Somm from Tennessee who wrote to the Postmaster General and said, we need a stamp honoring the military women. And this was before the commemoration of World War II started. And Postmaster General Marvin Runyon made a slight mistake, I think. He wrote back and said, but we're not going to do a stamp during the World War II commemoration. We're going to do it when the memorial is dedicated. Well, Mary sent us that letter, and we hadn't heard a thing about our stamp, couldn't get anything out of the post office. And I went to one of the inaugural events, and lo and behold, there was Marvin Runyon. And I said, Mr. Runyon, you wrote a letter and promised a stamp. And he said, I did. And I said, you sure did. And he said, well, we'll check into that. He said, I think that sounds like a good idea. And the following day, you know, one of his lieutenants called me and said, and with the process started, and today or tomorrow, you'll have your stamp. So three cheers for Marvin Runyon. Thank you. As we have As we have gone through this project, we've had some wonderful people who have supported it all of the way. And one of these is the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, or the former chairman. He just retired the other day. I'm still having trouble getting used to it. General John Shalikashvili. I don't need to introduce him because you all know who he is. But I do want to tell you that he cut short. He cut short his retirement vacation to be here tonight, to be with you. And not only that, tomorrow evening at the Candlelight March, which is just after the sun has shone all day, he and his wife, Joan, are going to be marching with us. General Shalikashvili.
You know, more than 2 years ago, I stood before many of you as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and as a soldier, immensely, immensely proud of our women in uniform. I observed then that it was long past due to bring the role of America's military women out of the dark shadows and into the bright light of the day. Well, tonight I'd stand here before you once more, but now as the former chairman, to tell you that time has not diminished how strongly I feel or how magnificent your accomplishments remain. And I am honored that you invited me back tonight to celebrate with so many of you here the culmination of a dream, the grand monument to our great women in uniform. A monument that celebrates the competence, the pride, the confidence, and the devotion to our nation that have been the hallmark of our women in uniform. And as I watched the monument to women in military service come to life at Arlington Cemetery, I was reminded of the words of an American author who reminded us that when women offer our experience to our truth, all maps will change. And so tomorrow, the map of Washington will change, so that we may, from tomorrow on, properly honor the memory of those women who have served and those who will serve this great nation of ours. And it is my hope that that monument will stir the hearts of each new generation of Americans. The pride, the joy, and the everlasting thanks we owe to all the women whose names are now recorded at this fitting and noble salute to our great patriots. For those women who have served this nation in so many different ways, let this monument serve as the reservoir of your memories and the launch pad of your dreams. And to all Americans, I say, bring your daughters and bring your sons so that they too may understand that those who toil and brave dangers in the name of freedom are exalted by all citizens. So tonight, I congratulate General Vaught, who worked so hard to make the monument possible. But I also know that great things are not done alone. So I salute as well all those whose dedication and teamwork made this celebration possible. Give yourself a hand. Let me tell you that I rejoice in your success. And tomorrow, as General Vaught said, I and my wife will stand once again with all of you to honor our women in military service. Thank you. God bless you all.
It isn't just enough to have friends in the military. Women have needed friends in other places, too. And one of those places is in Congress. And for many years, Pat Schroeder stood as a friend of ours. And she had always planned to be with us on dedication day, but you know, she resigned or retired or whatever one does to get out of the Congress. And she took another job, and she's in the book publishing business. She's with the Association of Book Publishers. And would you know, there was a big book fair scheduled in Germany, and she had to be there. And she asked me to be sure and tell you how much she regretted that and how much she thinks of all of you still. And let me tell you, she still reads the news about what's going on. But we have a new spokesperson now for women in the Congress. And I've been proud to have had the opportunity to be with her in her home district in Los Angeles, California. And I've read her many editorials about such things as sexual harassment and discrimination. And she stands and is counted for us. And she serves on the what used to be the Armed Services Committee, and it has a new name, and she'll have to tell you the new name. But Congresswoman Jane Harman from Los Angeles, California, welcome to 9,000 servicewomen, their families and friends.
Thank you, my dear. Thank you, Reverend. On behalf of 52 women members of the United States Congress, welcome. And thank you, Wilma, and more important, as you point out to me, thank you to the whole team that has put this wonderful event together. Tomorrow, with the official dedication of the Women in Military Service Memorial, America recognizes and remembers women who have given so much to our country. I am inspired by your service to the cause of freedom and honored to be here. This extraordinary happening is getting the word out. Women and men in all walks of life are finally learning of your sacrifices, your dedication, and your accomplishments. You did this in the face of overwhelming odds, often not enjoying the recognition you deserve, and you paved the way for other women to break into other unconventional roles in our society. For this, we are all indebted to you. As one of three women on the House National Security Committee, I have witnessed firsthand the impact you pioneers have had in the military and in society at large. I was there when my friend, the late Secretary of Defense Les Aspin, opened vast new roles to women in the military. His courageous act was the right thing to do, and it was because of the groundbreakers right here. Now women have achieved highly visible leadership roles. I was there when Lieutenant General Claudia Kennedy received her third star, and rightly so. She is indeed a star. I am proud to point to the role of women in developing key programs that support our military. Did you know that a woman is in charge of the precision-guided munitions program for the B-2 bomber? Did you know that a woman heads the tactical high-energy laser program, which protects Israel's northern border and our troops from Katyusha rockets? I guess you knew. As a co-chair of the National Security Committee's investigation of sexual harassment and misconduct in the military, I want to ensure that women serve in safety and can contribute to our full potential. This is not about political correctness, it's about combat readiness. Unless we include women as full partners in the military, we are not fielding the best team we need to fight and win our nation's next wars. I salute Brigadier General Pat Foote, who played a key role in the Army's recent groundbreaking report on gender issues. Pat, we hear you and we'll follow through. I have read many moving stories of women veterans, including one of a woman who resides in my California district, Gaylene McCartney. Gaylene was a medic at Oakland Naval Hospital in 1965, caring for the wounded from Vietnam. But that is only the beginning of her inspiring story. She became an attorney and then suffered painful disability that led her to curtail her legal activities. Yet she'll be here tomorrow and here volunteering on behalf of veterans and others, once a leader, always a leader. I'm equally inspired by the efforts of the women whose work made this week's celebration possible. Yes, Wilma Vaught, but also all the women behind her who put this together. Thank you. Thank you to some very, very competent women. Without you, there would be no memorial. I'm also pleased to read that the on-site project manager is a woman. Hope you knew that. Margaret Van Vost, who headed a team of women managers. And I was doubly pleased to hear that she is a graduate of my alma mater, Smith College, which has been a school for women for the last 140 years or so. No doubt General Shalley would agree that this really is the Women's Memorial. It honors women. It was made possible by women. It was even built by women. Let me close with a wonderful quote from President and former Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Theodore Roosevelt, who speaks to every woman here. Of course, I have edited it for gender. He said, "It is not the critic who counts, not the one who points out how the strong person stumbled. The credit belongs to the one who is actually in the arena, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again, who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, and spends herself in a worthy cause, who at the least, in the end, in who at the least knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if she fails, at the least while doing greatly, knows that her place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your patriotism. Thank you on behalf of a grateful nation.
I now want to introduce three people. Two of them have probably controlled things far more than their housemates would ever like it to be known. But they are two strong supporters of the memorial. But most importantly, I'm introducing now the man who for several years now was the number one person in defense, former Secretary of Defense Bill Perry, a friend of the memorial, and his wife, who strongly supported it, and Joan Shalikasvili. And I want us to pay a special tribute to Joan Shalikasvili and Lee Perry because they worked for us for years. So folks, come out here.
President Kennedy once said, "A nation reveals itself not only by the men and women it produces, but also by those it honors, those it remembers." Tomorrow, with the dedication at Arlington Cemetery of the Memorial for Women in Military Service for America, America is finally honoring, finally remembering the 2 million women who have served in this military services since the Revolutionary War. President Kennedy also said, "One person can make a difference, and every person should try." He must have been thinking of Wilma Vaught. Only rarely in our history has one person, man or woman, made such a difference. And tomorrow we will see the fruits of her labor. But perhaps even more important than the monument, the physical manifestation of Wilma's efforts, is the effect that she has had on the lives and on the thinking of thousands of us. Women veterans, of course, but men as well. In Yosemite Park, there is a plaque honoring Stephen Mather, the first director of the National Park Service. And it says of him, "There will never come an end to the good that he has done." I modify that slightly for Wilma. There will never come an end to the good that she has done. Thank you.
Now, Secretary Perry, I'm honored to tell you that tomorrow, when you visit the memorial, you're going to find that there are 11 quotations of the glass tablets on the Ark of Tablets at the top of the upper terrace, the skylight, and one of those is a quotation you made at the groundbreaking. And we are honored to have your name there with the names of our women veterans and what they said about their service. We thank you so very, very much.
Thank you.
A building usually comes about as a result of someone's dream, perhaps. It also happens when you begin to get other people involved. And if you're going to build a building, one of the things you need to do is to get an architect. And we chose our architect for the memorial by having a nationwide design competition. And I had hoped so much when we had that competition that one of the winners in some way would be a woman, or at least there'd be a woman involved with the team. Well, lo and behold, when we had finished that selection, it was a team of one man and one woman, whom I believe to be two of the most creative architects in the United States today. They have received honor after honor after honor, and they have done all of the design and creative work for your memorial. And so it's a great honor for me tonight and a great pleasure to introduce Marion Gale Weiss and Michael Manfredi, who are not only just our architects, they're a team all the way. And we consider them the first memorial marriage because they won that competition. And I don't know whether it was a success of that or what, but then they got married.
General Vaught, thank you for your kind remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, veterans, it's an honor to be here this evening, and it's been a privilege to help make your efforts and those who preceded you measurable and real. The site you will be standing on tomorrow will be for the first time part of Monumental Washington, part of the heart of Monumental Washington, a Monumental Washington planned by Pierre L'Enfant over 200 years ago. And it's been 200 years since women have been dedicating their lives in the defense of our country. It's now a chance to repay that debt. On a personal level, a debt to my mother, who's an Army nurse, and probably one of the only women wearing an Army helmet here tonight, hopefully not the only one. But also a chance to repay a debt to those who have inspired us. For the past several decades, the site of the memorial has remained incomplete, defined by the deteriorating neoclassical retaining wall of undecided symbolic content, a place without purpose at one of America's most significant sites, Arlington National Cemetery. When General Vaught secured this site and established a national design competition, it was a chance to reclaim this site, this space, for an important purpose, to tell your story. And now, finally, we have a chance to link this site with the family of monuments that we think of as Washington. The site you will see tomorrow is marked by a newly restored wall. For us, the barriers of stone and concrete of this hemicycle wall represent the barriers to greater opportunity and recognition than women have encountered in their efforts to serve our country. These barriers were formidable indeed, and sadly, many of them remain formidable to this day. Four new stairways, carved through the existing stone and concrete, symbolize women's efforts to break through these barriers and to ascend to a new upper terrace. Here you will be confronted with two views: the city of Washington with the Lincoln, Washington, and Capitol silhouetted against the sky, and a view of incomparable power, thousands upon thousands of tombstones that carpet the hills of Arlington Cemetery. Here on the upper terrace, these two views will be framed by an arc of glass tablets.
We were inspired by the women veterans we met. We listened to their stories and were overwhelmed by the sacrifices they made. Their stories and the stories of those who preceded them provided inspiration for the design, and an arc of glass tablets captures their words and the words spoken about them. As Michael described, the 250-foot arc of inscribed tablets is legible from the memorial terrace above,
Sunlight passing over these inscriptions creates changing shadows of the text on the walls of the gallery below and bring light into the interior spaces of the education center. Light makes visible the once invisible history of women's service. Women's voices are captured again by the sound of over 200 jets of water that flow together as one strong voice and come to rest in the reflecting pool. Passage, light, and water tell the story of women's dedication and sacrifice to the nation. Again this evening and during the events of the past 2 days, we've been moved by your courage, dedication, and sacrifice. Finally, with tomorrow's dedication, we will be able to create a memorial in your honor that will join the family of monuments that we know of as Washington. It has been a rare privilege to work on this sacred site and be entrusted with telling such an important story. To all of you veterans who assembled here this evening, and to all of those who preceded you, we are grateful for your inspiration. General Vaught, we thank you for this extraordinary opportunity, and we have a surprise for you. We have some sketches from the early part of our journey together on the design, and we thank you and all the veterans here for giving clarity to this vision.
Well, this will certainly find a place in the memorial. And we thank you for your work. We thank you for your support of women. Did you tell them your mother was an Army nurse?
I did indeed, and I think good. She's wearing her helmet this evening.
Oh, she's got her helmet on. So you can see the short lady with the helmet on. That's his mother. Look out.
She served 11 years in the Army Nurse Corps, and she had to get out because she was pregnant, and that was the rules back then, which was kind of funny because that was the real rules why I had to get out, too.
So my son paid me back.
She said her son paid her back.
And it's a great, great event. Wonderful. That's wonderful. All the vets that are here. Anybody from New Guinea? See me afterwards. We'll have some coconut juice.
Michael? Okay.
Oh, what do we got?
Well, as you can tell, when you're in the Army, you're used to giving orders, and my mother started me out very early, and I learned to accept those orders very quickly.
At this time, I'd like to introduce Colonel Brian Shelburne, the head of the Army, the United States Army Band.
Colonel Shelburne.
Thank you so very much, General Vaught, and good evening, distinguished participants and guests. I have the rare privilege of bringing you greetings from the women and the men in military music of all the armed services. All of us engaged in the making of music of the armed forces congratulate each of you on the success of the events this week. They have really been terrific, and they will be tomorrow as well. But this evening, I'm proud to introduce to you the most recent addition to the officer staff of the United States Army Band, Captain Beth Steele, Associate Director. Here now, please welcome Captain Steele and the United States Army Band, Pershing Zone.
Good
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The United States Army Band, commanded by Colonel L. Brian Shelburne, tonight, under the direction of Captain Beth Steele, is proud to present a musical salute to women in military service throughout the decades. American women have served in defense of our nation from the early days of colonial America to today's high-tech battlefield. Their contributions, often unrecognized and unrewarded, began with the early patriots. Despite the barriers that restricted women from enlisting in the Continental Army and local militias during the American Revolution, women took part in many ways, from daily resistance tactics of passing information, harboring patriot soldiers, and storing supplies for colonial troops, to disguising themselves as men to serve as soldiers fighting on the lines. During the War of 1812, women were employed as with military nurses. Although few names or details were documented, the logs of Commodore Decatur's ship, the United States, reveals the names Mary Allen and Mary Marshall entered as nurses. The Civil War remains a tumultuous watershed event in American history. The Civil War, indeed, opened a new phase of women's participation in war efforts. At home, women stepped in and managed plantations, businesses, and households. They formed aid societies, or bonnet brigades, providing uniform items, bandages, and other supplies to the armies. Government and regimental hospitals were staffed by Union nurses and matrons. Other women lived in the ranks, disguised as men, and served on the front lines of Civil War battlefields. One woman, Dr. Mary Walker, serving as acting assistant surgeon in the Union Army, earned the Medal of Honor for her service, the only American woman to receive our nation's highest military honor. During the Spanish-American War, the Surgeon General appointed Dr. Anita Newcomb McGee, then Vice President General of the Daughters of the American Revolution, to oversee the applications, acceptance, and deployment of nurses. Over 1,500 contract nurses served in Army and Navy hospitals, aboard the hospital ship Relief, in stateside camps, the Philippines, Puerto Rico, and Hawaii. Immune nurses who had already contracted yellow fever, including 32 black nurses, were assigned to higher risk hospitals in Cuba. Dr. McGee drafted Section 19 of the Army Reorganization Act, which granted permanent appointment of women nurses to the Army, thus founding the Army Nurse Corps. Early nurses participated in relief efforts for the San Francisco earthquake of 1906 and were present for the incursions along the U.S.-Mexico border in 1912 and again with General Pershing's forces against Pancho Villa in 1916. The Navy Nurse Corps was established in 1908, where Esther Voorhees Hasson, former nurse aboard the Relief during the Spanish-American War, became the first superintendent of the newly created corps, 20 nurses dubbed the Sacred 20. By the outset of World War I, 466 Navy nurses were ready to answer the call to duty. Throughout World War I, military nurses continued their legacy of service. By Armistice Day, over 21,000 Army nurses had joined and half had served overseas, assigned to field hospitals, mobile units, troop trains, transport ships, and military posts throughout Allied Europe and the Philippines. 18 black Red Cross nurses joined the Army Nurse Corps and were assigned to Camp Grant, Illinois, and Camp Sherman, Ohio. They lived in segregated quarters and cared for black soldiers and German prisoners of war. It was during World War I that women enlisted for the first time in the United States military. Women entered the Navy in 1917, where they served as Yeoman F, Masters at Arms, and mess attendants. By war's end, nearly 12,000 female yeomen or Yeoman F had served stateside. When faced with serious personnel shortages in August 1918, the Marine Corps enlisted 305 women Marine reservists for clerical duties to free men to fight. Over 200 bilingual telephone operators dubbed Hello Girls were recruited and trained by AT&T for overseas service in the U.S. Army Signal Corps. Women also served in volunteer organizations as war relief workers, doctors, and nurses for the American Red Cross, the Salvation Army, and in American women's hospitals. World War II generated a larger and more official participation by women in the war effort. While many Rosie the Riveters worked in munitions, defense, and shipbuilding factories, 400,000 women served in the military, nursing the wounded, ferrying planes, repairing weapons, and assuming desk jobs. Military women served overseas, came under enemy fire, and were held prisoners of war. They served in nearly all non-combat jobs in the Women's Army Auxiliary Corps, WAAC, which soon converted to Women's Army Corps, or WAC. Navy Women's Reserve, called Women Accepted for Volunteer Emergency Service, WAVES. Coast Guard SPARS, after the motto Semper Paratus, always ready. The Women Air Force Service Pilots, WASPs. And Women Marine Reserves. World War II also created more opportunities for minorities in the military. In January 1941, the Army opened its nurse corps to 56 black women. On June 25, 1941, Executive Order 8802 created the Fair Employment Practices Commission to eliminate racial discrimination in the defense program. The Army dropped its quota on black nurses in July 1944, and the Navy followed suit 6 months later. A group of Asian American WACs served as translators, interrogators, and interpreters. Native American and black women also enlisted as WACs, WAVES, and SPARS, and Carmen Contreras Boza became the first Hispanic woman in the Women's Army Corps. Throughout traveling shows, the USO provided a home away from home and a timeout from the war for the 12 million men and women in the armed forces.
He was a famous trumpet man around Chicago way. He had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was the top man of his craft. But then his number came up and he was gone with the draft. He's in the Army now, blowing reveille. Here's a boogie-woogie bugle boy, a company B. He puts the boys to sleep with boogie every night and wake him up and sing with in the early bright. They clap their hands and stomp their feet, cause they know how he plays when someone gives him the beat. Whoa, whoa, he breaks them up when he plays reveille. The boogie-woogie bugle boy, a company B. Go, boy, boogie boy, yeah. Boogie-woogie bugle boy, a company B.
Company B, Company B.
Although post-war demobilization diminished their numbers, some military women remained in the occupational forces. In 1947, President Truman signed the Army-Navy Nurses Act that established the Army and Navy Nurse Corps as permanent staff of the services and granted them officer status in the regular Army and Navy. It wasn't until 1948 that all women were given permanent status in the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. When the first ground troops landed in South Korea, July of 1950, 22,000 military women were on active duty. Although they were not drafted for the conflict, many women found their enlistments extended over presidential authorization, and some women reservists were recalled to active duty. Other than nurses, few women saw duty in Korea. Nurses, however, served in mobile Army surgical hospitals, field hospitals, hospital ships, and Air Force nurses flew evacuation missions. The Vietnam conflict again saw the presence of over 6,000 military nurses. Army, Navy, and Air Force nurses and medical specialists were the first women to deploy, and were the greatest number of American women to serve in theater. Although in small numbers, WAC, WAF, and women Marines were also present in Vietnam. Lieutenant Sharon Lane, Army Nurse Corps, who was killed in action, is among the 8 women who died in Vietnam. By the early 1970s, the military draft ended, opening the era of the all-volunteer force. Slowly, in this new era of peace, the number of women increased in the armed forces, and the walls that previously impeded their advancement were knocked down. In 1969, Air Force ROTC went co-educational. In 1970, saw the first women general officers, Brigadier General Anna May Hayes, Chief of the Army Nurse Corps, and Brigadier General Elizabeth Hoisington, Director of the Women's Army Corps. The service academies opened their doors to women in 1975. And in 1976, the Women's Army Corps deactivated, and the Coast Guard opened all assignments to women. By 1980, over 170,000 women were on active duty, making up almost 9% of the armed forces. In 1983, military women deployed to Grenada in Operation Urgent Fury. In 1989, 770 women deployed in Operation Just Cause in Panama. 3 female helicopter pilots came under heavy enemy fire. And as commander of the 988th Military Police Company, Captain Linda Bray directed her soldiers in a firefight against Panamanian defense forces. In performing their jobs, the combat line had been crossed. In the largest single deployment of women in U.S. military history, 41,000 women deployed to the Persian Gulf in support of operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm, providing the catalyst for changes in the military. Major General Jean J. Holm, U.S. Air Force retired, wrote, "During the operation, American military women did just about everything on land, at sea, and in the air, except engage in the actual fighting. And even there, the line was often blurred. The front lines were not what they used to be, and non-combat units regularly took casualties. Iraqi long-range artillery, and especially the surface-to-surface missiles, were unisex weapons that did not distinguish between combat and support troops. Women have continued to face higher risks as they deployed to operations in Honduras, Bosnia, Croatia, Somalia, Rwanda, and Haiti. As our ever-changing world presents new challenges, women in the military will continue serving with pride around the globe, preserving peace and defending our country's freedom. To each of you who expanded the horizons of our present-day opportunities by your courageous and selfless service, we who wear the uniform recognize that women in the military could not stand here today without the tireless efforts of the pioneers who came before. We salute you with this special song written by Rod McBrien, which says, "I will always remember you."
Tennessee, you are every generation's hope of all that we can be. All this land between the oceans is the home that you defend. You're my mother, you're my daughter, my sister, my friend.
No one ever had to ask you. You always knew standing up for what you know is right is all that you could do. Not one to look the other way, you chose to serve with pride
and dare to cross the boundaries, knowing God was on your side. And protecting freedom.
Once again, Brigadier General Wilma Vaught.
We're going to have a little transition time, and I want to introduce some people to you. And then we have a very special treat for you, and that's the Women's Memorial Alumni Band that are going to play a few selections of music. And these are members, these are an all-women's band, all-military women's band, and some of the members of it came from those original, the original WAC band, WAF band, Marine band, and some of those early women's bands. So don't go away. There's more to come, and they're getting ready. And will the band members please come over here so that you're ready to play? Or I might have to go play, and I don't know how. But I want to introduce now to you a very special person, one of our two World War I women, Anne Freeman. And she was a big hit at groundbreaking 2.5 years ago. And she just loved it all so much that she came back. She's going to be one of our ribbon cutters tomorrow. And she's a wonderful person. And what did you do during the war? Here.
I had a typewriter before me, and I typed, and I typed, and I typed. And I made 5 copies of everything. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. And Anne, we're still making 5 copies of everything, but we do it by computer now. And Fred Williamson, would you come up here? I want to take this opportunity, which I failed to do last night, to thank 2 particularly of our corporate sponsors, AT&T, one of our founders, and if you'll those of you who were here 2.5 years ago will recall that they gave us $1 million. That was the announcement 2.5 years ago. And tonight, we have another special announcement, and I'm going to let Fred Williamson, a retired Air Force officer who's been working for Eastman Kodak Company for many years, make this announcement. Fred, what's the announcement?
General Vaught, ladies and gentlemen, we're very pleased to announce that Eastman Kodak Company is going to contribute to the Memorial Fund $500,000. We know you've been some of our very best customers over the years, and we really appreciate that support. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, Kodak. Okay, there's another special group of people, because one of the highlights of the ceremony tomorrow, when the sun is shining, is going to be a flyover of airplanes, all piloted by women. And the C-141 crew, I don't know of any of the others, but the C-141 crew is here now. Where are you, folks? Whichever ones of you are handy, come up here now. Where are you? So we can give you a hand. Come on up. Come on up. Come on up. And here's the aircraft commander.
Okay, well, I didn't quite expect this, but, you know, it's a real pleasure and an extreme honor for us to be here. I heard about the finalized plans about 6 months ago, and I said, this is what we want to do, and we want to take an all-female crew, and here we are. And I want to say that we feel that it's a tribute for us, for all the ladies that have given so much in the world to wars, for the United States, in service. And for those that will come after us, we hope that we can set as fine an example for them. So thanks a lot, and God willing, yes, the sun will be shining, or at least the ceiling will be 2,500 feet tomorrow.
I think you're going to have one special passenger with you.
Oh, yes. We have a lady that is going to be a representative of the WASPs flying on our airplane to connect past, present, and I believe, are we still going to carry the future, the pilot candidate with us tomorrow? Yes, yes. So we're going to connect all the threads tomorrow afternoon on our flyover. And again, we just couldn't be more excited. And to the ladies of the 452nd Air Mobility Wing.
Isn't that great? And for any of you WASP that are out there, the WASP pilot's name is Don Seymour from New York. Now, let me see how my band is. You know, this is the premier inaugural performance of this band, and if they're good enough, who knows, we may have another big party and have them play again.
Thank you. Aren't they great? Thank you very much. It's been a real privilege for us to active duty currently to work with women of all services from all eras. Once again, I'm from the Army Band, United States Army Band, and these ladies trudged some 2 miles, some of them, through Arlington National Cemetery from the Metro to get to a rehearsal bright and early this morning at 9 o'clock. And we had about an hour to do rehearsal, and this is the product. I'm going to turn it over to another lady here. She's Charlotte Plummer Owen, former director of the Marine Corps Women's Band, and she's going to do Semper Fidelis March. Charlotte. Next, we want to bring up Chief Warrant Officer IV, Jeannie Pace, who was the first female commander of the Old Guard Fife and Drum Corps at Fort Myer. She's going to do Colonel Bogey, which I'm sure a lot of you will remember. Thank you. Before we close tonight, we wanted to give all of you a chance to join us. I've asked the ladies in the band who served in all five services to stand when we play the service songs. Now we're gonna play the service songs from the old days. Whack is a Soldier Too, and Chief Warrant Officer 4, Jeannie Pace, is gonna conduct that. And we'll play March of the Women Marines, and Charlotte Plummer Owen is gonna conduct that. And we'll play Waves of the Navy. Lucille Kemper from the U.S. Navy Wave, she will conduct that. And I get to do Women Air Force Service Pilots and Spar Victory March. So we ask you to join along with us, and I've asked the ladies in the band to stand when we play their service song. The Whack is a Soldier Too. March of the Women Marines.
Women Air Force Service Pilots. Thank you. Spar Victory March.
Song. Now, this is not the end of the evening. You don't have to go away. But one of our charter members named Pat Sheehan wrote a song called It's About Time. And it's about time we built a memorial. It may be in your program so that you can sing it. Well, everybody join in because I think you'll have it by the second go-round. So, band, it's about time.
About time we had a big parade, ringing the bells, tooting our horns. It's about time. It's about time we shared our country's pride, knowing in war we helped to turn the tide. It's about time we had a big parade, ringing the bells, tooting our horns. All about time we had to prove ourselves to all that to time we called for wars to cease, time that we marched to have a lasting peace. It's about time we had a big parade, ringing the bells, shooting our horns. It's all about time we had to prove ourselves to all that to the task we're equal. Our jobs are sometimes monumental, sometimes whimsical. It's about time we called for wars to cease, time that we marched to have a lasting peace. It's about time we had a big parade, ringing the bells, tooting our horns. It's about time.
You've heard the big song, It's About Time. It is about time, and tomorrow it will be time. If we haven't sold out, I suspect we're still saying things back there, but I want to thank you, each and every one of you, for making such a wonderful evening. For those of us, the staff of the foundation, all of the many volunteers who worked so hard to put this together, and I hope that before it's all over, I get a chance to shake hands with all of you and tell you how much you mean to me. And now, the finale. Good night. But you don't have to leave yet, but this is the end of the show. So thank you, thank you, thank you. they're playing Auld Lang Syne. Just know that tomorrow begins a new day for military women.